friends and comrades. I'm particularly elated and honored to be here for three major reasons. One, that Academy has invited me, and this historical Academy, which has been supporting and encouraging stalwarts like I can see some of them, I can recognize. And I'm here today in the same hall in which these great people have spoken, have been writing, and they have been criticized probably and absorbed in this particular hall. The second reason is that we are celebrating life and work of one of the most important intellectual, an intellectual which has shaped not only European thought processes, but also has shaped our thought processes and intensely affected the left movement in the country. The third reason is that whenever I come to this land, Kerala, I feel I have traveled far off from it, the past India where I live. I live in an India which is going backwards and has been living probably in 14th, 15th century. And here is a land, a part of India, which is still moving forward and for moving forward at such a fast pace, you are being attacked and penalized. But the resistance that has been put up by Kerala and the people of Kerala also is like a lamp of hope for us in other parts of the country. I chose to speak on identity politics and our constitution, and therefore I would like to talk a little bit about what is this Indian identity. I've been talking about it for quite some time. I think that one should begin from 1857. 1857 is a landmark for me and for many of us because it was the greatest revolt that the earth has ever seen. It was the largest and the biggest revolt of against imperialism, which ultimately was quenched and suppressed with a very heavy hand by the imperialism. There were reasons why we lost, and the reasons have been elaborated upon by many historians, sociologists, philosophers across the country as well as abroad. But what are the lessons that imperialism learned during that period? And what are the lessons that we learned after 1857? Imperialism learned a very aggressive lesson that Indians have to be divided. This divided society, already divided society, has to be kept intact, and the wedges that run crisscross across our culture, multidisciplinary, multidimensional, multilingual culture, those wedges, those trenches need to be enlarged, and they have to be filled with a lot of hatred. They tried to divide us across and use whatever division existed across the castes, across the regions, across the religion, even how we eat and how we speak to each other and relate to each other became campaigns for creating hatred by the imperialist forces. The other lesson they learned was that they have to propagate very, very aggressively that imperialism is an agent of creating civilizations across the world. It's an agent which has come to civilize not only India but Africa, Latin America and all other parts of the world. This was very, very aggressively propagated among the colonies and people wherever they were ruling. A very large section of population in most of the parts where they went almost accepted this proposition that the white race and imperialism have come to civilize us. The third lesson they tried to teach was that whether you accept that we are a reality and we are there to rule you and we are there to civilize you or not, we are there. We'll oppress you, and if there is a need, we'll kill you, but you'll have to accept our hegemony. What did we learn from 1857? We learned that this imperialism is all powerful, and therefore by force we probably cannot achieve independence. We also learned that since India was completely, Indian population was completely divided between the rulers, the Rajas, Maharajas, Nawabs, Zamindars and the oppressed sections of society. We were divided on caste lines, we were divided on religious lines, we were divided on linguistic boundaries, and therefore we could not win the war. So the major project of the leadership that emerged after 1857 was, in my opinion, to create an identity which was overarching identity, which could be called Indian identity. All these small identities, which I call pygmy identities, including religious identities, could not have built dream of an India, dream of a united India. Who was the other for this identity? Because I've written about it that the other is as important in building your identity as self is. Without the other, you cannot imagine yourself. And therefore, the other which we had was naturally imperialism. It was a very, very gigantic identity. As I said, that they had already created notions that they rule the entire globe. They are civilizing agent. They are the repository of new knowledge, science and technology. They are all powerful. So it's a big, huge identity which becomes our, the other. And therefore it's essential for building the self to be as big as the other. Without that, you cannot fight. You cannot fight the battle for freedom. This realization results into two, three things in our country. One, that the basis of creating the identity cannot be religion. Though Muslim leadership, especially run by the Rajas and Maharajas and Zamindars, were arguing very clearly that if British go from here, then we should become the rulers of the country. Because when British came, we were the rulers, so it should be returned back to us. Whereas Hindu leadership was saying that we have been under rule of outsiders, aliens, for 1500 years. So if British go from here, the nation should become a Hindu nation. Now these two identities excluded each other. Similarly, caste identity could not have been as gigantic as the identity that was required to unite the country. So how do you do that? How do you build an Indian identity? What should be the elements that go into building this idol of Indianness? In my opinion, the secular ideas, which we know of as equality of human beings, equality of gender, education for all, land rights, universal suffrage, you name the whole list of things, these notions have always existed in all cultures. But till modernity came, all these notions were always at the periphery of the social consciousness. The mainstream philosophy, the mainstream religion, and the mainstream social consciousness always was very, very divisive before the modernity took over the world. Yet, when these notions come to us, which already were there in our culture, otherwise Tukaram would have not been born. Many of the writers and poets of that ancient period to medieval period wouldn't have been born. These ideas come to us anew. They come to us from the West, and they become the basis for creating an Indian identity. Now think of a society which is completely divided. We are divided across religions. Just one can leave it, one doesn't have to argue. But education for all? No. The dominant philosophy and the social structure didn't allow education for all. In fact, if shloka went to your ears and you happened to be from the lowest strata of the society, we poured molten metal into your ears. So you couldn't get educated if you were born in a lower caste. If you are a woman, no, absolutely not, you couldn't be educated. So you had no right to get educated if you had been born in certain castes. Equality of human beings, absolutely not. How can a Dalit and a Brahmin be equal human beings? No, absolutely not. Right to property and land? No, only a small section of society had this right to property in our dominant philosophy and dominant structure, social structure. So all these rights were not there. It is over 90 years of a struggle that we gradually carve out an Indian identity which includes everybody. And the biggest performers who contribute to carving this identity were, on the one hand, within Congress, Nehru and Gandhi, and on the other hand, the left, which became very aggressive proponent of these ideas of equality of human beings, contributed to building this idol of India. you couldn't afford to leave the last man. And therefore these values, which we call normally as secular values, became the rock bed for constructing the identity that was Indian identity. It was as big as the imperialist, the other. And therefore, over a period of time, gradually, our freedom movement gained momentum. People started participating from every section of society, from every geographical location. Without this, we couldn't have won the war of independence. There are many ways of looking at how we won the war. This is one way of looking at it, which is my way of looking. That without including the last man, about which Gandhi keeps talking in various speeches and writings throughout his life, without that, we wouldn't have won this war. And this Indian identity, which was very, very gigantic, suddenly loses the other after independence. So what do? The natural shift is from British imperialism to anti-American imperialism. And in 60s and 70s, up till 70s, we are against, pitch ourselves against American imperialism or world imperialism. It is only after that the shift takes place. Why does that happen? Now we have, let me come to, before I come to the reasons for what happened later on, let's look at the Constitution. The Constitution becomes a book which collects all the elements of this Indian identity and codify them. But a large number of those who were playing leading role did not in their personal lives believe in those values. A very large number of them did not practice equality of human beings themselves. A very large number of them did not practice equality of gender, and a large number of leaders even today do not practice equality of gender in our country, including some of those who claim to be left-oriented. A very large number of them do not, at that point of time, did not want masses to get free, fair, universal education. They were against it. Yet they signed this particular document. 600 of them in the parliament. And I'm certain that most of them did not practice those values which were written in the Constitution in their personal lives and homes and with the family. So why did they sign it? Why was not the Constitution rejected by the majority? Why was it accepted? In my opinion, the reason are 2-3. The most important reason was that those who did not believe in secularism, those who did not believe in equality of human beings and gender and was casteist in their personal lives, they practiced untouchability in their personal lives, did not have intellectual capability to write a book that could be called Constitution of India. That was one of the major reasons probably. And they left it to people like Ambedkar, who were intellectuals of very high order, Nehru and many others. The other reason was much more important. The other reason was that they thought, let these lunatics like Ambedkar and Nehru and people from the left, the communists, who were participating in the debate very vehemently, let them write whatever they want to write in this book. Maybe if they write beautiful language and beautiful words, the entire globe will clap. But conditions in India will not change. We'll not let it change. The balance of power will remain in our favor. We'll keep practicing casteism. We'll keep practicing communalism. We'll keep practicing untouchability. We'll not let women go out of the four walls of the home, etc., etc. They had this confidence, and therefore they said, you write whatever you want to write in the constitution. But over a period of time, as education spread, as people became more and more confident in the democratic processes that were being built over a period of time, various sections, including women, started asserting their right, which was written in the constitution. And gradually changes started coming about. Up till Nehru's period, the Congress party did not have to play identity card. For them, Indian identity was more than sufficient to appeal to people. And therefore, Nehru talked about secularism, Nehru talked about scientific temper in the country. And it was more than sufficient to be in the power under Nehru's leadership. But once the other is gone, how do you deal with the situation? The pygmy identities of religion, of caste, of language, of region started asserting themselves. And political leadership of young India after Nehru thought, like Britishers and like rulers previous to British Empire, that let's keep this structure intact. It's highly oppressive structure, let's keep it intact. It works very well. It has had a legacy of 2,000, 3,000, 4,000 years. The rulers have used it for such a long time. It works very, very efficiently as far as oppression is concerned. So in order to keep the people, majority, oppressed, they started using various kinds of identities where the other, these pygmy identities had the other, like in Maharashtra you have the other, which is Bihari or Bhaiya. You use it for election. If you today talk about imperialism and freedom struggle and this and that, it doesn't make too much of sense to the younger ones. So in order to divide, you use regional identity, caste identity, and religious identity. Pakistan was based on a pygmy identity, which was religious identity, which was against the Hindu India. Now, over a period of time, we in India landed up in a situation where we kept on reducing the height of our gigantic Indian identity, which was opposed to imperialism, to a very, very small identity, which was sometimes against Pakistan and sometimes against Bangladesh or Nepal or places like that, and sometimes against people within. This was a sure shot road to give boost to fascist ideology. RSS, in my opinion, committed a mistake just after RSS and Hindu Mahasabha put together, committed the biggest mistake just after independence. They killed Gandhi. And Gandhi was such a respected person in India at that particular time that people turned against them. And the anger took a lot of time to go away. But RSS was bidding for a pygmy identity, that is religious Hindu identity. But religious Hindu identity is a problem, is a major problem, because there is nothing like one Hindu. There's no one text, no one God, no one way of worshipping that you can call Hindu way of worshipping. You can't call a way of eating as this is what is Hindu way of eating. It is a multicultural social structure which is given the name Hindu. The only thing that defines, in my opinion, Hinduism, I may be wrong, I am not a sociologist or a historian or a philosopher of religion. I may be completely wrong, but as far as I think, the only thing that defines what is Hindu is the caste system. If you are born Hindu and you are born in a caste, then you remain a Hindu. Except that nothing else defines you as a Hindu. You may believe in God, you may not believe in God, you still remain a Hindu. So RSS had a major problem before it. It had seen that Muslims could unite Muslims in the name of God, in the name of Quran, in the name of Namaz, in the name of La ilaha illallah, and carve out a country there. Pygmy identity, yet it was a cohesive identity. Here is a problem that you are divided across caste and many other things, even the way of eating and how do you clothe yourself. And then Savarkar comes and provides a definition of Hindu. What is Hindu? Which is not a religious definition, and as per Professor K. N. Panikkar, and I am quoting him, that this is the definition which is a political definition. That Hindus are those jinki pujya bhumi or janam bhumi Hindustan mein hai. And then you include Jains and Buddhists and Sikhs into the definition, broad definition of what is a Hindu. And try to construct a fictitious Hindu identity which includes all Hindus who are born here and whose place of worship is in India. But it's not easy for them. One, that they have killed Gandhi, and there is anger against them, and after killing Gandhi they distributed sweets in shakhas, and people were very, very angry with them. They were beaten up, their offices were burned, etc., etc. So for a long time this anger continued, but there was a political problem as well which they were facing. How do you unite everybody? Over a period of time they have been working, and they could work and find only one way of appealing to the people and trying to bring them within a broad umbrella, which was communal divide. But communal divide could define the other. How do you define self? So the self was defined as those people who believe in Hindu Rashtra. over a period of time after independence, they very aggressively worked towards building Hindu Rashtra. And they have been spreading all kinds of lies, all kinds of wrong things, anti-science and anti-rationality. Yet they have been very, very aggressive in propagating those ideas. This cannot happen without creating a fascistic mind. This fascistic mind over a period of time has been created in the crucible of RSS shakhas. And it's very difficult to convince this mind which they have created. So as I understand, you were saying that ask for the job, ask that question, where are the jobs? Ask that question, where is the development? This mind is not going to be dissuaded by such questions. They are fascist. They understand very well that they have to support BJP government, that they have to support RSS, because it's their own RSS and it's going to create Hindu Rashtra. So if they don't create jobs, it's fine. If development doesn't happen, it's fine. If there is bloodshed on the streets, it's fine with them. They have to keep the power and keep a very strong grip on the power. What I'm trying to say is that it's like if my friend is fighting an election and he tells 20 lies, and knows, and I also know, that he is not going to fulfill those promises, yet if it is necessary to win the election to tell those lies, I will be very happy if he says all those good things to win the election. And after that, I won't be feeling very uneasy because he has won election. So this big lump in India, which is fascistic mind, is not getting disturbed if you ask those questions. Those are very important questions. I am not belittling them. But don't think that you can embarrass Modi, you can embarrass Jogi, you can embarrass RSS, you can embarrass Amit Shah by asking those questions. They are shameless fascists. They will not get disturbed. Because they are trying to convince every Indian, within quotes, the Hindu Indian, that we are trying to build a Hindu Rashtra. For that, if you get killed, fine. For that, if you have to go on the borders, it's fine. For that, if you have to drag out a young boy from a train and kill him, it's fine. It's fine by them. So who is our target? Whom should we appeal to? Who are those who are going to stand against this fascism and those people who are day in and day out hitting at the constitution itself? If you say that they are against constitution, the RSS shakha attending young man is going to say, we are very happy, let this constitution go. Who will be disturbed when you say that they are hitting this constitution? And they should be our constituency. When we enter into debate with RSS, when we enter into debate with BJP against this identity politics that they are using across the country, who should be our friend? we need to identify those sections. And in my opinion, the Dalits, the minorities, are one part of this whole game. They are worried today. Yes, minorities are very worried. Yes, Dalits are very worried. Muslims, Christians, even Sikhs are very, very worried today. Parsis are worried today. Even Buddhists are worried today. Though they are included in the definition of Hindu Rashtra, but they are very worried. But is it sufficient to appeal to these sections and then think that we'll be able to save the country? No, I don't think. They're extremely important, and they should become part of the struggle, and the left should look towards them to provide the cadre in today's India. I'm sure and certain that if left and democratic forces make an effort to draw cadre from these sections, Dalits and Muslims and minorities, other minorities, yes, they'll be willing to join hands. Which we have not sufficiently done till today. We have not really gone with our ideological positions to these sections of society. We should be doing that. But it's not a sufficient condition, in my opinion, in the period when this identity crisis that India is facing, as far as Indian identity is concerned, and on the other hand, there are forces, fascist forces, which are almost day in and day out exploiting this situation and using identity politics to gain more and more power in various parts of the country. We need to appeal to that section of society which has played a major role in constructing the secular identity. I think if the majority of any country gives up the responsibility of constructing its own secular identity, then nobody can save that country or that society. And therefore, it's historical responsibility of the left, in my opinion, to regain grounds among the majority based on the same values. It's a difficult task. It's not an easy task. I do understand that. We can create islands in the country like Kerala, or maybe tomorrow regain West Bengal, which I don't hope is going to happen very soon, or Tripura, or maybe we can gain momentum in Himachal Pradesh, where we are seriously a threat to both BJP and Congress. But it's our historical responsibility today of the left and democratic forces to gain that momentum where people can regain their confidence in secularism. We cannot use, in front of this intense onslaught on constitution as well as secular values, old methods and old jargons and old idioms. We have to think of new language, new methods, new creative ways of approaching the younger generation. We day in and day out, as the vanguard of the left consciousness, keep saying that we are not getting the younger generation in sufficient numbers. We are unable to attract them. Why has it happened? Let's ask that question. There must be something wrong with us. I don't think that there is wrong with the younger generation. Younger generation is also human beings and citizens of the country like we were at one point of time. So somewhere the younger generation has moved forward and we are still lagging behind. This is a dangerous situation. We have to immediately take highly corrective measures and immediate corrective measures in order to alter the situation. Maybe give leadership to the younger ones because they understand their own generation. We don't understand. Those who are above 60, because technology has moved at such a fast pace that we have lagged behind. Most of those people who are above 60 do not know how to handle their own cell phone and generally ask their young ones to solve any problem which comes with the cell phone itself. Things are changing. Changing at a very fast pace. And in this condition, how that technology was used by RSS to approach the younger ones, we need to learn from that. The most outmoded, the most irrational ideas were spread through the latest technology and are getting spread through latest technology. The identity politics is being propagated by using cell phones, WhatsApp and Twitter and whatnot. How do we score? Does our leadership know how to use Twitter? Does our leadership know how to make use of Facebook? Do we have WhatsApp? This is the cyber world which has been created by latest technology. Are we familiar with this cyber world? Do we have a good website of the web, of the left parties? We need to ask these questions before blaming the younger generation. Younger generation which is rejected as consumerists. Younger generation which is rejected as people who are only worried about their salaries. No, they are not. They are also worried about the country. They also love music like we loved music. They also love good books like we loved good books. But now today, they would like to read their books on their cell phones. That is the difference that has come about. And we are unable to communicate with them. Their idioms are different, their language is different, their way of dealing with the world is different today. And I'm not talking about the younger generation of middle classes. I'm also talking about the working class. There's been a major change that has come about in the entire world, and working class of today is not working class of yesterday. Yes, they are oppressed and probably more oppressed than they were oppressed in 19th and 20th century. But the way they relate with the world is very different. And in this vacuum of ideology and propagation of ideas of the left, the fascists have pitched in very efficiently, at least in India. If you look at the international scenario, yes, revolution is on the back burner today. But there's no reason why it should have been on the back burner in India. In India, we thought that after Soviet Union has fallen, we would become the leaders of revolution and revolutionary thoughts in the world. But have we played our historical role? No. We have to think about it. The last point that I want to make is that you have resisted here in Kerala this identity politics which is based on pygmy identity politics. I said that I call them pygmy identities. You have resisted for a very long time. But the onslaught is very, very intense. There's going to be more intense attack on Kerala. Because RSS realizes they can buy all other parties. All bourgeois regional parties are sellable commodities. And we have seen how they have bought people in Bihar. We have seen how they were bought in other states like Goa and many other areas, including recent elections in Gujarat. So even Congress party is sellable commodity. If somebody wins, you just buy them. It's only the left which is not sellable commodity in the country. And therefore they know the strength of the left. Probably we don't know how strong we are. We keep thinking that we are weak, we are weak, we are weak, we are weak. But if you look at the map of India, a very substantial part of India looks red. If you try to paint where are we strong and where are the struggles going on, then left parties put together are a major force to reckon with. We may not realize, but RSS realizes that. And they know that ultimate battle for supremacy and creation of Hindu Rashtra is going to be between RSS and the left. And therefore this attack, after decimation of Congress, will keep on increasing on every communist in the country. They have tried to build an image of communists in recent past, that those, and the simple message that is being given, at least in northern part of India, is that those who want to break the country are communists, or vice versa. All communists want to break the country. This campaign is intense campaign, and the attack is going to be very intense on communists in the entire country. But on major receiving end would be Kerala, because that is where you are organizationally, politically and ideologically strongest. As I said, that you are inspiration for us who live in that part of India. And you are most hated one as far as RSS is concerned. They are waiting for the right moment and opportune time. Be prepared for that onslaught. Don't live in this paradise thinking that paradise is indestructible. They will destroy it. We have to prepare for that struggle now, so that when attack comes, we should have a blueprint how we are going to resist it. I can't predict in what shape it will come. Maybe it comes in the shape of 356, Article 356. Maybe it comes in the shape of buying all the Congress people and building a BJP, fascist BJP here. I don't know. There could be very many blueprints that can be thought of. But I have no doubt that intense attack is going to come on Kerala. How will other communists in other parts of the country will react? How will you approach them at that particular time? These questions have to be thought of today very seriously. You have to build links and reach out to secular and left and democratic sections elsewhere in the country. Up till now, you have beautifully built a culture of resistance, a culture of left in Kerala. But that is not sufficient. This identity politics is different from soft identity politics of the Congress, which was happening for a very long time. This identity politics is fascistic identity politics. And therefore, it's our responsibility, who are sitting in Delhi and other parts of the country, as well as your responsibility, to reach out to other parts of the country and people and sections of people who can stand with you when the onslaught comes. I'm sure that all these questions are being thought of very seriously by intellectuals sitting here in this room, as well as the political leadership of Kerala. You have to find solution. Otherwise, we are almost doomed. I normally finish off whatever speech or poems on a very hopeful note. But today, at the age of 61, I'm not really very hopeful. And I would like you to also feel, I'm sure you are feeling, the urgency. I always say that India, despite all its problems, is a beautiful experiment that humanity is conducting in this part of the world, where you have democracy of all kinds, where you have bourgeoisie sitting there oppressing and not worried about the masses, where you also have people and governments which are left, which have done wonders and have taken up such large projects as Janvigyan Jatha, KSSP. We have not theorized on them, but we have done great jobs. That makes India, even of today, where you can hate so many things that you see around, a great experiment of humanity. If this experiment fails, which was predicted just after the independence, that India will fail within 10 years or 15 years of its existence, it has not failed till now. But if it fails, then it will have a major impact on humanity. If fascism grips India, then we are one in seven human beings on planet Earth. if what happened in Germany and Italy and Europe happens to India, it's the entire humanity which is going to get affected. I think it's our responsibility to not let that happen. With that note, I say thank you very much.